Bibles, turn to Ephesians chapter 4. We'll be looking at verses 7 through 13 this morning. Ephesians 4, 7 through 13. We're continuing on this early part of Ephesians chapter 4. Remember, we talked about this, that transition from the primarily theological to the primarily practical and action-oriented, what to do with the truths that Paul's already given. So Ephesians chapter 4, beginning in verse 7, Paul says, "But grace was given to each one of us according to the measure of Christ's gift. Therefore it says, when he ascended on high, he led a host of captives, and he gave gifts to men. In saying he ascended, what does it mean but that he had also descended into the lower regions, the earth? He who descended is the one who also ascended far above all the heavens, that he might fill all things. And he gave the apostles, the prophets, the evangelists, the shepherds, and teachers to equip the saints for the work of the ministry, for building up of the body of Christ, until we all attain to the unity of the faith and of the knowledge of the Son of God, to mature manhood, to the measure of the stature of the fullness of Christ." Let's pray. Lord, we do come before you again. We thank you for the privilege of walking through these passages. I thank you that we can come together and we can learn from your word. I pray that you would help us each to set aside the distractions, the things that are clamoring for our attention. Let's set those aside for the time being. Help us to be able to focus on your word. I pray that you would challenge us. I pray that you would encourage us. And I pray, Lord, that you would send us out of here later today with a renewed desire to share this gospel, to live it out. Glorify your name through all we do. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen. So last week, we looked at the righteous unity that comes from the one Spirit, the one hope, the one Lord, the one faith, the one baptism, the one Father. Paul spent a lot of time talking about the unity that comes from Christ, the unity the church is supposed to have. Our unity comes from knowledge. It comes from acting on God's word. We've said this before, we'll say it again. Many churches seek unity by abandoning gospel truth, biblical truth. But that always ends in failure. When I decide that there's a doctrine that's controversial, some people won't like that doctrine, so we're just going to ignore that doctrine. We'll put it on the shelf. We won't talk about that doctrine. Well, what we find out happens is that shelf gets full, pretty full with doctrines, because we debate, we disagree. Again, in our American church, I think many churches are filled with unbelievers, thinking they're believers, claiming to be believers. So we put those doctrines on the shelf. Well, that ends in failure. It doesn't end in unity. So we gain unity by knowing God's word, by acting on God's word. In our passage today, Paul is continuing on this line of thought, this idea of unity and how the church is to function. Today we'll look at the gifts that our Lord gave to the church to help build unity and advance the gospel into the world. Because that's the point. That's the point. The church is the body of Christ. We come together, we worship God, but we also grow together to take the gospel to the world that needs it. Verses 11 through 13, the second half of our passage, are going to explain the what and the why of Jesus' gifts. He gets into these gifts of the apostles and prophets and things like that. We're gonna jump into that. But before that, verses 7 through 10 are going to paint this incredible picture of our gracious Lord, the conquering King. Let's jump right in and take a look at that. So we look at verses 7 through 10. We see Christ's grace in victory. Verse 7 says, "But grace was given to each one of us according to the measure of Christ's gift." So in verses 4 through 6 that we looked at last week, Paul talked in universal terms. He talked, he said, all Christ followers have one Lord, one faith, one hope. We all have the same Father. There's a universality of that. And I think that's important for us to get as Americans. You know, America was really built on this idea of the rugged individual, right? And there's good and bad to that. Not entirely bad, but I think a lot of times we take that rugged individually and we apply it to our American-style Christianity. So it's just me and God. Me and God have a thing going. But when you read the pages of the New Testament, we're called to live in community. We're called to live together, the church. I mean, this letter, who was this letter written to? The Ephesians. Not Bob, the Ephesian. It was written to the Ephesians, the church in Ephesus. So we have this, there's this unity that we're all to have, certainly. But now we see that grace was given to each of us. So there's a unity, there's a universality, if that's even a word, I'm not sure, but it sounds good in my head. There's all of us have the same Lord and same Father, but we also individually have grace given to us. We have giftings that are unique and individual. God doesn't just work through the group, he also works with the individual. I think back to the end of the book of John, the Gospel of John, John 21, when Jesus, at the very end, the last chapter, the last few verses, Jesus has risen. Peter has said, I go fishing. I'm of the opinion that Peter was given up. I know there's some debate on that and some would disagree with that, but I think Peter was going back to fishing. And they're out there and there's a recap of or a repeat of when Peter met Jesus the first time. Peter's out, they catch nothing. It's very interesting, but Jesus is on the beach, he calls them in, he has food for them, but then he eventually takes Peter aside. Because remember, Peter was the denier. Peter is the one who said, I'll die for you. And then he ended up denying Christ three times at the arrest. So Jesus takes Peter aside in verse 15, John 21, 15. Says, when he had finished breakfast, Jesus said to Simon Peter, Simon, son of John, do you love me more than these? And he said to him, yes, Lord, you know that I love you. He said, feed my lambs. And Jesus does this three times. It's very interesting that Jesus, there's nothing magical to it, but I think this psychologically helped Peter. Because Peter denied Jesus three times. And Jesus here on this beach says, do you love me? Will you affirm me? And he does it three times. It's not an accident. It's powerful. But Jesus is dealing with Peter individually, as an individual person, uniquely. There's power to that. Later in the chapter, verses 20 through 22, as Jesus is, getting done talking to Peter here, Peter turned and saw the disciple whom Jesus loved following them. He's talking about John. John's writing this. He never refers to himself as John. He's always the disciple that Jesus loved. When Peter saw him, he said to Jesus, what about this man? And Jesus says, if it's my will that he return until I come, what is that to you? You follow me. We see this individual plan. Jesus has a different plan for John than he did for Peter. And he's very blunt. What does it matter to you? John's not on your path. John's not running your race. You don't worry about John. You follow me. I've got a path for you. I've got a plan and a purpose for you. So certainly the church as a whole, God has a plan for, but also he works in individuals. He works uniquely in individuals. Jesus gives differing gifts and differing amounts of gifts. And this is important for us to understand and accept. I think sometimes we accept that God gives differing gifts. Like we just got done singing and the people up here in our praise team, I can't sing. I can't sing. I've tried. I've tried to be up here in the praise team, and they won't let me. Fridays when they're practicing, they push me out. No, they don't. But I don't have that gift. And we accept that. Okay, I have this gift. I don't have this gift. But the idea of differing amounts, that hurts us. That hurts our pride. Are there people more gifted than me? Well, yeah. Yeah. There's people in this congregation more gifted than me, certainly. And we have to come to grips with that. We think of, you know, think of the Apostle Paul, who literally wrote half of the New Testament. You know, did God give him more gifting than Jude, who wrote a one chapter little book? Maybe. You know, but the point that's being made here, and this is that verse, that grace was given to each one of us according to the measure of Christ's gift. He gives differing gifts and differing amounts of gifts. We have to accept this because God's gifts are not for our glory. They're for God's glory, for His purposes. A lot of times we think God's gifts are for our glory. So God's got to give me more gifts so I can have more glory because that'll glorify Him somehow. No, He's given us each our own path. I don't need to be Billy Graham or John MacArthur or the Apostle Paul to glorify God. That's not my path. You know, my path isn't Billy Graham's path. It isn't. We can be thankful and thank God for the Billy Grahams, the John MacArthurs, or whoever. You know, if you walk into my office, you'll see there's books everywhere. And they're written by men who have far more gifting than myself. And I thank God for them because those are the resources I use in my study. We don't have to have, you know, the most or bestest, the biggest amount of gifting to glorify God. Just be faithful. I may be more gifted than some. I may be less gifted than others, but God gifted me specifically to honor Him. And you are no different. God has gifted you for the path He made for you. That's powerful for us to understand. God's grace in giving the gifts and specifically which giftings for the path He's given you. And now here we see the incredible word picture of Jesus the Conqueror. Paul paints these incredible word pictures. We see Jesus is the generous conqueror. Therefore it says, when He ascended on high, He led a host of captives, and He gave gifts to men. Now Paul is referring back to Psalm 68. And Psalm 68 is a song of victory. Psalm 68 verse 1 says, God shall arise, His enemies shall be scattered, those who hate Him shall flee before Him. This is a song of victory. And even in our lives, we haven't, you know, we've gotten glimpses of this, but not necessarily, we haven't seen the final judgment that's coming, the final victory of Christ. But David in this psalm, he's prophetically talking, he's talking about who, you know, God's ultimate victory. God shall arise, His enemies will be scattered. Verses 17 and 18 of that same chapter says, the chariots of God are twice 10,000, thousands upon thousands. The Lord is among them. Sinai is now in the sanctuary. You ascended on high, leading a host of captives in your train and receiving gifts among men, even among the rebellious, that the Lord God may dwell there. So this song of victory, and Paul is quoting this verse 18, you ascended on high, leading a host of captives. I do think it's interesting in verse 17, though, of that chapter, the chariots of God are twice 10,000, thousands upon thousands. Remember in the Garden of Gethsemane when Jesus is going to be arrested, and Peter wants to fight. He's got the sword. You know, when he cuts off the servant's ear, that's not like trick shooting where he is like, ha ha, right? That's incompetence. He wasn't trying to cut anyone's ear off. He was trying to kill somebody. He just wasn't very good of a sword. He's incompetently trying to defend his master. And Jesus stops and says, Peter, I could call 12,000 angels. You know, 12, what is it? 12 legions of angels. I think that's the phrase. And you get this Old Testament concept of God's chariots, his armies encompass thousands upon thousands of chariots, these words. There's this picture that Paul's painting here. The picture is of a conquering king returning in glory to his capital. He's got prisoners. He's got plunder. In the Roman world that Paul's writing, I mean, Roman citizens would have been used to this. You know, the Roman general coming back to Rome with the prisoners of war trailing behind. They're going to be enslaved or killed, but they're being paraded as war captives. There's plunder that's coming. There's a parade. The Romans are cheering for their king, and it's not just the Romans. I mean, even David, Old Testament Israel, understood this concept of the conquering king coming in with his plunder, with his captives, and the nation cheering. This is a powerful picture. Now, there's some debate amongst theologians who the captives are, because this victorious king is coming back and he's got these captives. And so there's some debate as who the captives are. Some think they're demonic entities that Jesus defeated through his death and resurrection, that he defeated the powers of evil. So they're chained and bound, and he's bringing them. And that may be. Some good theologians have different views of this. Others think that these captives are redeemed men and women, once enemies, but now captivated by Christ. I think it's interesting. I tend to think it's the latter. I tend to think he's referring to redeemed people. You can disagree with me. That's okay. But you notice that he is ascending, bringing them to his capital. The end result of demonic forces, satanic forces, is not coming back to heaven, right? They're going to be cast into the lake of fire. But either way, whether he's bringing his defeated enemies, the wicked forces, or he's bringing these redeemed people, once enemies but now redeemed, either way, the picture here, the word picture, is Jesus is victorious. He's won. He paid the penalty for sin. He conquered death. He made the way of redemption for rebels like us. Jesus won, and he's marching in victoriously. This is powerful. And what we see here is that in this verse is that Jesus doesn't just defeat his enemies. He's not just a conquering king, a tyrant who stomps those who oppose him. Jesus doesn't just defeat his enemies, he gives generous gifts to his people. Psalm 68 mentions the king receiving gifts. But Paul says the king gives gifts. So Psalm 68:18 says that you ascend on high, leading a host of captives in your train and receiving gifts among men. And then Paul, when he's quoting this, he says he ascended on high, led a host of captives, and gave gifts to men. Okay? So there's a little bit of change in what Paul says here. I think it's kind of interesting here. This is no mistake. Paul doesn't get this wrong. He doesn't make a mistake here. The victorious king certainly would receive plunder, would receive tribute from fallen enemies. David would understand this. This would have happened to David. This would have happened to any ancient king. They would conquer a people and they would receive tribute. You know, basically, stop fighting us. We give up. Here's all our stuff of value. That would be true. But the king would also give generous gifts to his armies. He'd give generous gifts to his followers. This was part of that culture. And these gifts will be the focus of the next few verses as he talks about the gifts that he gives to the church. But before we dive into that, Paul has a short discussion about Jesus' ascension. So I think we got a little ahead on the slides. We're going to look at Jesus is the condescending conqueror. Jesus is the condescending conqueror. And that word, I don't know if that word rubs anyone else the wrong way. I chose the word and it rubs me the wrong way. But it's interesting that he says this. In the ESV, it's in parentheses. These next couple verses are in parentheses. He says, in saying he ascended, what does it mean but that he had also descended into the lower regions of the earth? He who descended is the one who also ascended far above all the heavens, that he might fill all things. So the word condescending usually has a negative meaning, right? If you talk about somebody who was condescending in their attitude, we usually think of someone who's acting like or thinking that they're better than us, talking down to us. It's a funny story. When I was in college, I went to college in Wisconsin, and I lived in Michigan. So we had this eight-hour drive going back and forth, holidays and weekends and things. One long weekend, we had a chance to go to Michigan. So me and a buddy, we got in my head this little Chevy S10, little short bed and short cab. So, I mean, the seat was like this wide. So me and a buddy, we're going to drive to Michigan. And there was a girl from the college. Her dad was on staff. He was a college professor. He was my English professor, actually. And she was a cheerleader. And she had family back in Michigan, found out we were going to be going to Michigan. So she hitched a ride with us. And so there's three of us in this little tiny Chevy S10. This is close quarters. But this girl, she was one of the smart kids in school. Okay, she was smart. Her dad was an English professor. And the first 8 hours of this trip going to Michigan were pretty silent. She wasn't too impressed with us, my buddy and I. You guys have met me. You probably understand. She wasn't very impressed with us. And so we have the weekend on the, you know, as the day's coming, we pick her up and we're about to drive back. And her nose is up, like she's better than us. And as we start to drive back, my buddy was a chucklehead. Okay, he was kind of like me, but a little more ADHD than me. So there's that. He's kind of a chucklehead, and she has no interest in talking. It's uncomfortable car ride, and so I look at him and I said, "Hey, why don't you tell her what you got in your SATs? No, the ACTs. ACTs. That's the test you take to get into college. You know." And he looks at me and goes, "No, I don't want to tell her." And I go, no, tell her what you got in your ACTs. And he goes, "I don't want to." And you could see the look in her eyes because you know what she's thinking. And she's like, "No, tell me what you got." And there's almost this evil glint in her eyes. It's incredible. Well, if you know anything about the ACTs, the max back in the 90s was 32. That was top. And I go, "Tell her what you got." He goes, "I got a 32. And he did. He was brilliant. He was a chucklehead, but he was brilliant. And as soon as I said that, it was interesting to see in her eyes, her it was like a switch flipped, and she realized, "Oh, I'm not smarter than him." And I think mine, I didn't have a 32, but mine was better than hers. And almost immediately, she realized she wasn't better than us, at least in this her mindset. And then the rest of the trip was really fun, because this condescension that she had, thinking she was better than us, was gone. And we enjoyed talking and everything. It was interesting. It was fascinating, this moment. When we think of condensation, or not condensation, that's a different word. Condescension. That's why my ACT wasn't that good. I tell you what, yes, it was. It was. And I got a good grade because I guessed well. I'll just put it that way. But anyway, when we think of someone who's condescending, who thinks they're better than you, you know, that has a negative connotation to it. But when we think of Jesus as condescending, well, he really is better than us, right? He's God incarnate. He's the perfect man. He took on human flesh. He literally came down to our level. Jesus really did condescend. He came down to us to save us, not just to hang out, not just to affirm us in our sin, but to provide the way of salvation. Philippians chapter 2 says, "Have this mind among yourselves, which is yours in Christ Jesus, who though he was in the form of God," which means he's God, he's in the essence of God, he's God, "did not count equality with God a thing to be grasped, to be held onto, but emptied himself by taking the form of a servant, by being born in the likeness of men, by being found in human form, he humbled himself by becoming obedient to the point of death, even death on the cross." Jesus is God. God eternal in glory sets aside the glory. He doesn't stop being God, but he sets aside his glory, takes on human flesh, comes down to our level. That's what Christ did. He's the condescending conqueror. He came down to us. It says he descended to the lower regions, the earth. Now, lower regions, there's the grammar behind lower regions, the earth, can be taken several different ways. Most likely it refers to the grave, that Jesus came down, not just to earth, but he died. He was put in the ground in death. Jesus didn't just take on human flesh. He died as the final sacrifice for sin. He was placed in a cave tomb. So he descended even into the earth. I think that's powerful. But he didn't stay there. You know, he died, he was buried, but he didn't stay dead, he didn't stay buried. He conquered death. He rose from the dead, he ascended back to heaven. And one day all creation will be filled with his glory. That's that idea that he might fill all things. Again, Philippians 2, verse 9, therefore God has highly exalted him because Jesus descended, because he humbled himself, providing the way of salvation. Therefore God has highly exalted him and bestowed upon him the name that is above every name, so that the name of Jesus every knee should bow, in heaven and on earth and under the earth, and every tongue confess that Jesus Christ is Lord, to the glory of God the Father. This is who Jesus is. Sometimes we sing the song, Jesus, Son of God, who's let his name, you know, his name be higher, his name be lifted up. There's no other name to be saved by. Jesus is the name above all names. He's the condescending conqueror. Now, as Paul has already stated, God made the way of salvation to create a people for himself. He took spiritually dead sinners, alienated and separated from him. That's our starting point. And he gave us life and hope. And to this new assembly, to this church, he gave some very particular gifts. So we're going to take a look in the next few verses at the purpose of Christ's purpose in gifting. Why does Christ give these gifts? Well, the particular gifts he speaks of in verse 11, he gave the apostles, he gave the prophets, he gave the evangelists, he gave the shepherds and teachers. Notice that Paul doesn't say he gave apostleship, or he gave prophecy. He doesn't say he gave apostleship or prophecy. Paul is saying that the people are gifts. The apostles were gifts to the church. The prophets, the evangelists, the shepherds, and teachers. It's interesting how he puts it. There are other passages in Scripture that talk about different spiritual gifts, but in this list, he's talking about the people that have this gifting. This is humbling, and honestly, it's terrifying. Thinking of, you know, God's gifting, God has given you and me as gifts to the church. You know, it's humbling. But it's also scary. It's also frightening because, oh man, there's a heavy responsibility. But he goes through this list. We won't spend a lot of time talking about each individual one. But the apostles are literally the sent ones. That's what the word apostle means. There were specifically 13 apostles. And when you think of 13, you know, there's the 12, and then there's Paul. When you read through the book of Acts, sometimes you wonder if, did Peter jump the gun? And I don't know that he did or not, but, I mean, Paul's not saved yet, and they replaced Judas with, was it Matthias? Is that who they replaced? I see my mature believers. Yeah, I knew that. who was the other guy? It was Justice, right? No, Matthias and... Who was the other guy that they voted between? Oh man, I'm derailing here. All right, so the apostles, there's these 13 apostles, right? The 12 and Paul. They walked with Jesus. We think of Paul's 3 years in the wilderness in Galatians 1, he mentions. But they walked with Jesus. They were foundational to the early church. These are the guys who planted churches. They spread the gospel. They wrote the books. They took the missionary journeys, right? These guys were foundational to the early church. Those guys are all dead now. Those apostles are all gone. But I will say this, that the word apostle, lowercase a apostle, right? Because the capital A apostles are dead, they're gone. But the lowercase a apostle, sent ones, someone who is sent by his master. Well, I will say this, God still calls people to serve him. God still sends people out with the gospel. When we say amen at the end of this service, you're going to be dismissed not to go to your homes and insulate yourselves and then come back next Sunday. You are going to go out here with the call to share the gospel, to take the message with you, to live it out. There is a sense in which there are lowercase a apostles, ones who are sent. We see the prophets, the apostles, those sent ones, prophets, those who speak forth, that's the idea there. The Old Testament prophets would speak forth new revelations from God. You know, we see their books in the Old Testament. Those are the revelations from God. In the New Testament time, God used men to speak and write his revelation. We think of the New Testament himself, right? Jude writes revelation from God. Peter writes revelation from God. So God does use these people to write new revelations, to speak authoritatively in the early church. God used those men. Now, I think what we see today is God's word is complete. That which is perfect has come. The Bible is complete. It's finished. There are no more new revelations as such. If somebody comes out and says, hey, you know, I've been writing this new book. It's Revelation 2, Third Peter, I'm still writing books. No, that's the scripture's finished. The scripture is complete. But we still do speak with authority from God's word. We still have people that speak with authority, and I think we need to. Part of my job is to speak with authority, not from my own, because I'm so smart, but because I'm reading God's word. I'm going to tell you what God's word says. So we do have people that speak forth from God's word. We see the evangelists. They're proclaimers of the good news. All Christ followers are called, in some sense, to share the gospel, to point people to Christ. That's part of our job, guys. You didn't get saved to sit in an easy chair. You got saved. God saved you to give you a responsibility, give you work to do. And part of that is to point people to Christ. But there are those who are specifically gifted, specifically focused. It's a neat thing when you see someone who just has that gift of evangelism, that can, whether it's an attitude of fearlessness. I know a lot of us, the idea of talking to a stranger about the gospel, what do they say? So sometimes there's that. Sometimes just the wisdom and the smoothness of being able to share the gospel, that's powerful. But God gives evangelists as gifts to the church. And then he gives the pastor teachers. These are the overseers of the congregation. Now this may refer to one category of gifting as pastor teacher, or two different groups with overlapping skills and responsibilities, pastors and teachers. Different translations translate a little bit different because the grammar, it's a little, they're definitely very closely related. While the apostles, the prophets, the evangelists may be the special and extraordinary ministers to the church, the pastor teachers are the ordinary, the everyday ministers to the assembly. The pastors teachers are the guys that are there, day in and day out. That's the gifting, that leadership. Peter says this in 1 Peter 5. He says, so I exhort the elders among you as a fellow elder. And this elder is a similar concept to pastor teachers, these guys who oversee. And as a witness of the sufferings of Christ, as well as a partaker in the glory that is going to be revealed, shepherd the flock of God that is among you, exercising oversight, not under compulsion, but willingly, as God would have you, not for shameful gain, but eagerly, not domineering over those in your charge, but being examples to the flock. And when the chief shepherd appears, you will receive the unfading crown of glory. So this is Peter describing to pastors, teachers, how to do their job. How do you exercise this gifting? And I think that's powerful because we do see, in our culture and maybe even around the world, we see people who claim to be pastor teachers who don't operate like this. We do see men who think they are the king of their little, I refer to them as little potentates. They think they're kings of their little kingdoms. They think they're here to be served. I think there's when we do the Lord's table, when we observe the Lord's table, I learned this from one of my pastors growing up. In a very small church, there's that possibility of as the pastor to go hand out all, do the serving, which I think is good. In a bigger congregation, it just doesn't, logistically doesn't work well. So what we end up doing is the deacons take the elements out, pass them out, serve, and then when the deacons come back to them, they hand me the plate, and then I take the plate and I serve them. I had my college professor, he would be served, like a college president. He described this as he would have the deacons serve him. And like that picture just doesn't work well. That's not the picture here. The idea of what we would do is, this pastor teacher is the servant, is the one who serves. Certainly he's going to teach. Certainly he's going to lead, but he's going to lead by example. He's going to lead with grace and mercy, not seeking shameful gain. So Peter gives a strong example here of this gift to the church. And he says, Jesus gives these gifts to the church for a purpose. So he gives these four gifts to the church, and there's a purpose for them. Verse 12 says, to equip the saints for the work of ministry, for building up the body of Christ. So the first purpose for these gifts is to equip and prepare. The church is not a rest home. It's not a country club. And in our membership class, we're very clear on that. You don't join the church, this church or any other. You don't join the church so you can go, stretch out your legs and, pull the leg thing on the easy boy and just kind of lay back. That's not what the church is about. The church is the people of God called to proclaim his glory. We don't work to earn salvation, but God has a job for his people. The job of these ministers is to prepare the church to do just that, to proclaim God's glory. That's the purpose of the church. This happens as we live out gospel principles. It happens as we speak out the gospel message. And we can only do those things as we are taught and as we are encouraged and challenged. So you can't glorify God if you don't know anything about God. We see this in our culture. There are churches that are super excited about a Jesus they don't know very well. How do you know? Are you pointing people to the real Jesus? There's a lot of fake Jesuses, always has been. We have to know who Jesus is. We have to know God's word. Part of these ministers in the church is to equip, to teach, and then to challenge. Challenge us to go out. Push us to go out. Hebrews 10 talks about provoking one another to righteousness. And that's one of my favorite verses, my favorite ideas here. We think of usually we provoke one another to anger. We push each other's buttons to make our siblings mad. And what Hebrews says, no, you need to push each other's buttons to grow each other in righteousness. Push each other in righteousness, in godliness, in active service. We have to learn and grow. And I say we because ministers are still part of the body. I've known some pastors who thought they were not part of the body. It's my job. I'm doing this for them. And I don't think you see that in Scripture. We ministers are still part of the body. As a pastor, as whatever gifting God has given us, we're still part of this of the body. My job as pastor is to help equip you for the work of the ministry, but I'm also to do the work of the ministry. I'm also part of this local assembly. So equip and prepare. Verse 13 goes on, until we all attain to the unity of the faith and the knowledge of the Son of God. So to build unity, again, we come back to this concept. Paul keeps bringing up this concept of unity. You'd think it was important or something. This is a process, okay? We are growing in our faith. We're growing in our preparedness and our understanding. We're not going to be perfect at it. We're not going to, you know, it's not going to be a momentary, I don't know, some of you guys are old enough to remember the movie The Matrix. Anyone remember the movie Matrix? It was a big deal back in like 2000. Most of the young kids have no idea. But there was this scene where the main character, he had to learn how to fight. And so they take him into a computer program and like, you know, plug a thing into his head and they download Kung Fu. And so within a moment, he becomes this fighting master. And I think sometimes we have this thought that that's how our spirituality should be. Okay, I trust in Christ. I put my faith in Christ. Now I should have it all downloaded. Everything should be perfect. And when it's not, when I don't respond perfectly every time, I get frustrated because I should know this. And I think it's important to understand that our growth is a process. We grow in our faith. We grow in our preparedness, in our understanding, but it takes time. Don't get frustrated if you're not where you want to be. We will be growing in our knowledge of the Son of God for the rest of our lives. And I would say this, we'll be growing in our knowledge of Christ throughout eternity. Because when I stand before God, when I die and I enter God's kingdom and he shows me the door with my name on it in his house, well, I'll have eternal life, but I'm not going to be omniscient. I'm not going to be God. I'm not going to be all powerful. There's still going to be things I have to learn. If I have an infinite God and I have a finite mind, I will be learning about this God up to and including eternity. I will always be learning. I think that's incredible. Don't get frustrated by that. Tell people every once in a while, as you're growing in your faith, every once in a while, look back at where you've come from. Sometimes we don't want to do that. You know, when Jesus tells us not to look back, you know, the guy, the farmer who's plowing, if he looks back, he's not worthy. What Jesus is talking about is you looking back at the old life. Oh, I want that. And that's where you get off track. What I'm saying, though, is every once in a while, just do a progress check. How far have I come? What was I like 5 years ago? What was I like 2 years ago? Encourage yourself with that kind of growth. If you're growing in your faith, you'll see that. I might not be what I should be, but I'm not what I was. So don't get frustrated if you're not where you want to be. Continue to grow. Our call is to be faithful, to strive to love God rightly, and to love our neighbor rightly. That's our job. Strive for that. And you will learn more about God. You will love God more rightly as you grow, and you'll love your neighbor more rightly as you grow. And he goes on, he finishes up. He talks about equipping and preparing, building unity, and finally to increase Christ-likeness, to mature manhood, to the measure of the stature of the fullness of Christ. So part of the purpose of these gifts is to increase Christ-likeness in the church, in the individual believer. Maturing in our faith. We talk about that a lot, growing in our faith. Well, maturing in our faith means growing in our knowledge, learning more about God. We have to. You can't. You can't grow in your faith if you don't learn more about God. You can't. And then we grow in our knowledge of God. We grow in our trust for God. Because the more I know about him, the more I know how he keeps his promises. Hey, I've read in the scripture how God has kept his promises. I've looked in history and I've seen it in real life. God keeps his promises. Now I can trust him more. I grow in my trust for him. And then I need to grow in my patience. Because God, you know, God doesn't operate on my time scale. That's the most frustrating thing in the Christian life, isn't it? That God doesn't operate on our time scale. Okay, God. Okay. I've been praying for this thing for 5 minutes now. So get on the ball. I need this prayer answered post haste, right? We talk about George Mueller. English man who ran orphanages. One of his decisions early on in his ministry was that he would never overtly ask for money. He was going to pray pray for support. He'd pray that God would support his ministry, and he would never ask for money. And in the 1800s, over the course of his orphanage ministry, over $7 million, today's money, came in unrequested. He would get letters with money in it. Saying, you know, God pressed on my heart to send this. I don't know if you need it. We always need it, right? George Mueller was the guy that, if you ever read his autobiography, or his biography, I don't think he wrote it himself, but read a biography of George Mueller. There were times when they'd be sitting down to a meal with these orphans, and there's no food. And he prays and thanks God for the food that God provided. There's no food. And while he's praying, there'd be a knock on the door. And some wagon with bread broke down, and like, I can't. Or some wagon with milk. I'm like, oh, I can't do anything. You guys need it? I mean, there's these moments where God answered George Mueller's prayers almost instantaneously. But there's also a time. Mueller had three friends that he prayed for, that he prayed for their salvation. Three men that he wanted to see saved. And he prayed for them faithfully for 40 years. Four decades he prays for these men. One got saved shortly before Mueller died. One got saved at Mueller's funeral, and one got saved later after the funeral. He didn't live to see God answer two out of three of those prayers, yet God answered the prayers. What we see in George Mueller is a patience. He had grown in his faith. I trust God, I will have patience. It's never easy, it's never fun. But this is what maturing in our faith means, growing in our knowledge, growing in our trust, growing in our patience. It means more and more to think like Christ, to value what Christ values, to react the way Christ would react. That's the purpose of these gifts, to equip and prepare, to build unity, and to increase Christ-likeness. When we read the pages of Scripture, we see that God has big plans for his church. Romans 8, beginning in verse 28, Paul says this. He says, and we know that for those who love God, all things work together for good. For those who are called according to his purpose. For those whom he foreknew, he also predestined to be conformed to the image of his son, in order that he might be the firstborn among many brothers. And those whom he predestined, he also called. And those whom he called, he also justified. And those whom he justified, he also glorified. God's plan for his church is to be conformed to the image of his son, to bring him glory. Jesus generously gifts ministers to guide the church. So I'll give you a challenge and we'll be done here. But in light of all of this, will you participate in the gospel ministry that God gives us? Will you participate in this? Will you strive and grow? Will you minister and serve? Will you strive to grow in your faith? That takes effort. Not to earn salvation, but to grow in our faith, to get to know God, to get to trust God, to grow in our patience. You know, that's always the most dangerous thing. Never pray for patience. Don't do that. Don't do it, because that's a scary thing. And I say that tongue in cheek. But will you strive to mature in your faith, to proclaim God's glory? And will you obey God's call to point people to him? Maybe you sit here and you're like, well, you know what? I'm not a capital A apostle. None of us are. I'm not a prophet. I'm not an evangelist. I'm not a pastor. So I don't have to do any of this, right? That's not what Paul's saying. We're called to minister. We're called to serve. Will you obey God's call to point people to him? I'm going to ask Karen to come to the piano. I'll give you a moment to respond to God's word. If you're here and you're a believer, you know Christ. You've trusted Christ. Your Savior is generous in his gifts. He's given you talents. He's given you abilities. Are you preparing to use them for his glory? You know, sometimes we have gifts that we are using for our own glory. Sometimes we have gifts that we are just ignoring completely, that we aren't even developing for any use. Will you prepare to use your gifting for his glory? Are you striving for godly unity with your brothers and sisters in Christ? And again, as we say, I mean, if you're sitting here like, man, I am. I'm striving. Not perfectly, but I am striving. I want to glorify God. Then I want you to thank God. Ask him to continue to strengthen you and give you wisdom. But maybe you're here and you're like, I'm not. I'm not doing that. I'm distracted. I'm completely distracted. I want you to confess that to him, not to me. I'm not your priest. Confess that to him. Commit to strive faithfully. Maybe you're here and you're not a believer. You don't know Christ. But through his death, burial, and resurrection, Jesus made the way for you to be saved. He offers you forgiveness. He offers you eternal life. Let me challenge you. Would you call on him today? Would you simply trust in him today? I'm going to pray. We'll have the piano play for a moment. Our prayer team is standing by. Take a moment and speak with God. Lord, we come before you. We thank you that we can unpack this passage. We can see just the greatness of who Christ is. He's the victorious conqueror. He's the generous conqueror. He's the condescending conqueror. He's come down to our level to offer salvation. I pray that we would be a people that glorify him. Help us to be a people, Lord, that strive to honor him as we prepare ourselves for ministry, as we actively serve him. We actively take the gospel into the world around us. I pray that you'd be with those who are saved, those who know you as Savior. Challenge us, Lord. Strengthen us. Help us to commit to glorifying and serving you. And then, Lord, I pray for those who don't know you as Savior yet, that are lost in their sins currently. And I pray that you would open their eyes, let them see their need for salvation, and let them see, Lord, your grace in offering it. And I pray that you would draw them to yourselves. We ask you to guide and direct. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Thank you.